Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fair Game by Annette Dashofy, narrated by Romy Nordlinger. 1. Vance Township Police Chief Pete Adams shifted his gaze from the report he was working on to the small burgundy velvet box on his desk. He'd been in law enforcement for almost 20 years, half of that in the city of Pittsburgh. He'd faced down crackheads and killers. Last spring, he'd even taken a bullet. But nothing he'd ever experienced terrified him as much as what was inside that little velvet box. The intercom on his desk buzzed, followed by his secretary's staticky voice. "Chief, there's a man here who wants to speak with you." A man. Nancy would have given a name had she known it, so not a regular. She'd come to know nearly everyone who lived in Vance Township, so probably not a resident. Pete clicked into a different screen on his computer, one that showed the four different security camera views, including the vestibule out front. He'd guessed right. He didn't recognize the guy standing at the reception window. Pete stashed the velvet box in his desk drawer, locked it, and hit the intercom button. "I'll be right out." Attired in khaki cargo pants and a short-sleeved polo with a company logo on the breast, the stranger stood too tall, his shoulders hiked a little too high, his smile a little too forced. Not someone accustomed to facing law enforcement, and if he was trying to fake being at ease, he was a damned lousy actor. Pete extended a hand. "Chief Pete Adams, how can I help you?" "Victor Hewitt," the stranger said, clasping the hand. His mouth tightened, and for a moment, Pete thought Hewitt might change his mind and beat a hasty retreat. He ran his tongue across his lips. "I think I need to report a murder." Zoe Chambers tried to remember the last time she'd competed in a horse show. It had to be close to 20 years ago at the county fair when she'd been a teenager in 4-H. As she stood in the aisle of the pony barn at the Monongahela County Fairgrounds in the sweltering August heat, she vacillated between feeling like that 18-year-old again and feeling like Methuselah. Decades ago, the pony barn only housed ponies, but in recent years, it also stabled horses during fair week, which started tomorrow, Saturday. Today was the day when everyone hauled in their livestock, entered their produce, and set up their exhibits. In other words, madness. Behind Zoe, her quarter horse gelding paced circles in the stall and snorted his displeasure. "Yeah," she said to him, "I don't know what we're doing here either." Patsy Green, Zoe's second cousin and barn helper at home, bustled in, lugging two bales of hay. "Yes, you do." "Yes, I do." Zoe took one of the bales and set it in front of Windstar's stall. "You made me come." For the gazillionth time, he'd have been a nervous wreck being the only horse left at home. True. Not including her own horse, Zoe kept three boarders at her money pit farm. The pair of young girls who owned two of the horses were 4-H'ers, participating in the county roundup held at the fair. Patsy's Arabian mare was the third boarder, and Patsy had decided for some idiotic reason to enter Jazzle in the open halter classes this year, which would have left Windstar alone in his pasture, whinnying endlessly for his buddies. Considering his current stall walking and head tossing, he wasn't too happy in this strange location either, despite Jazzle's proximity in the next stall. "I don't know why you're complaining." Patsy thumped her bale on the ground, straightened, and ran her arm across her sweaty forehead. "We've got a nice camper out back. That'll be like a week-long slumber party." Zoe dug her penknife from her jeans pocket and sliced the twine on the bale. "Last time I spent a week here, I slept on a cot in the barn." She loosened a compressed flake of hay from the bale, slid open the stall door, and tossed it to her edgy gelding. The food did the trick. He stopped pacing and started ripping into the hay. Hey, if that's what you prefer, I'll happily keep the camper to myself. No, thank you. As Zoe pocketed her knife, a scuffle and a scream rolled down the barn from the far end of the aisle. Catch him, someone shouted. She looked toward the commotion, expecting to see a loose horse. The animal, however, wasn't loose. Not technically. A small girl, maybe 6 or 7 years old, was holding onto the end of a lead rope attached to a fat spotted pony who was struggling to get free. The pinto bumped into buckets, sending them clattering, stumbled into a tack trunk, and wheeled in an attempt to bolt. The little girl held on. Adults and bigger kids scrambled to grab the rope, which only further spooked the pony. It crashed into a wheelbarrow, half jumping, half falling over it. The collision jerked the rope, and the girl, who tumbled face first onto the dirt floor. The lead rope ripped from her hands, and the pony hit the ground, rolled, and clambered to its feet. Free at last, it took off at a dead run toward Zoe and Patsy's end of the barn. A pair of teens made an unsuccessful grab at the speedy little beast, but it dodged them, leaving only Zoe and Patsy between it and the door, and the rest of the county fairgrounds. Side by side, they spread their arms. A two-woman barricade between the wild-eyed, charging pony and the great outdoors. The pony slowed slightly, trying to decide what to do. Then it sped up and churned toward the gap between the two women, committed to getting the heck out of there. Zoe lunged as it attempted to sail past her, snagged the trailing lead rope in one hand, a fistful of flying mane in the other. Patsy had made a similar move from the other side, grabbing the escapee around its neck. Used to having much bigger horses attempt to drag her, Zoe dug in her heels, threw her weight back. Water skiing without the water, or the skis. She was vaguely aware that Patsy had again mirrored her actions. The pinto may have been able to overpower a small girl. Two women took a bit more effort. Had it been wild and untrained, or just plain rank, it might have continued to battle and would have won. But being a kid's pet and scared, the pony surrendered and stopped at the doors. Still clinging to the pony and the rope, Zoe got her feet under her, aware of a half dozen adults and older teens surrounding them. Seasoned horsemen, speaking softly, moving slowly, deliberately, so as not to set off the jittery beast. Windstar nickered through the bars on the upper half of his stall. Zoe wondered if he was trying to soothe the pony or saying, "Better luck next time, kid." A man in a rumpled plaid shirt thudded over to them and took the rope from Zoe.
"I've got him," he said, breathing hard.
She looked down the aisle toward the little girl who'd face-planted in her failed attempt to maintain control. A woman was on her knees with a howling child gathered in her arms. Zoe overheard snippets of conversation from the group who'd reclaimed possession of the pony. After hearing someone say, "Broken arm," Zoe caught Patsy's eye. Her cousin gestured to her, "Go." Zoe grabbed a duffel bag she'd stashed behind a pair of folded lawn chairs leaning against Windstar's stall and strode down the aisle to the girl. The woman cradling her looked up, tears streaking her face. Zoe dropped to her knees next to them and offered a comforting smile. "I'm a paramedic. Let me have a look."
"Who's been murdered?" Pete asked.
Victor Hewitt stuffed his hands in his pants pockets.
"That's the thing. I don't know. And I don't think it's happened yet. At least I hope it hasn't. That's why I'm here. I want you to stop it."
Pete eyed his secretary, who shrugged. To Hewitt, he said,
"Come with me."
A few minutes later, they were seated in the station's conference room, Pete at the head of the long table, Hewitt catty-corner from him. Pete opened his notebook and settled his reading glasses on his nose.
"Tell me about this murder you want me to stop." Hewitt squirmed, trying to get comfortable. I'm traveling on business and spent last night at the Vance Motel.
Pete knew the place. Small, one-story, outside entrances to about 20 clean and tidy rooms. Situated on what used to be a main route until the four-lane went in, the motel now struggled to make ends meet. But to owner Sandy Gidon's credit, she'd refused to rent rooms to riffraff and had kept it family-friendly.
I was on the verge of falling asleep, Hewitt continued, when voices from the next room woke me up.
Shouting?
He considered the question.
Not really shouting. Loud, though. The walls of that place are like tissue paper. At first, I couldn't make out what they were saying. I mean, I was trying to tune them out and go to sleep.
Hewitt ran a hand across his mouth.
But then one of them said, I want him dead. I'm gonna kill him myself.
Is that exactly what was said?
Exactly. I'll never forget it.
What else?
The other guy was quieter, keeping his voice low. I couldn't hear what he was saying, but it sounded like he was trying to calm the loudmouth down.
Could you make out anything else?
He said it a couple more times. I'm gonna kill him.
Hewitt lowered his head.
Actually, his exact words were, I'm gonna kill the son of a bitch for what he's done. And that was it. I heard the door over there slam, so one of them must have left.
Did you happen to get up and look out the window?
A description of the man or his vehicle would be nice.
No, I guess I should have. But I thought, you know, maybe he was drunk and blowing off steam.
Did he sound drunk?
No. Maybe. I don't know.
And you think he was just blowing off steam?
At the time, but then I couldn't fall asleep. The more I thought about it, the more I wondered, you know?
Yeah.
Pete kept the annoyance from his voice.
You're sure it was two men?
Positive. And one of them left?
I think so.
Did he come back?
Hewitt's eyes widened for a moment.
Oh, I don't know. If he did, I didn't hear him.
When you left this morning, did you see a car that might have belonged to the occupant?
No. They must have checked out before I did.
Hewitt shifted in his seat.
I honestly didn't know what to do. I thought about minding my own business and not saying anything, but I kept thinking, what if I see a news report about a murder back here? I'd always wondered if I could have stopped it. Then I spotted this place as I was driving by.
He waved a hand, indicating the station,
and decided I needed to report what I heard.
Pete collected Hewitt's contact information in case he needed to reach him, thanked him, and sent him on his way. Two men, one loud, threats of murder. Pete closed his notebook, tucked it and his glasses into his pocket, and headed to the front of the station. Odds were good the guy was simply venting to a friend. Angry, maybe drunk. Nancy looked up from her desk as Pete tugged on his VTPD cap.
I'll be back in a bit, he told her. I'm heading over to the Vance Motel to talk to Sandy Gidon.
2. The motel sat on a well-manicured knoll. The lawn, green despite the dry summer, showed evidence of a sprinkler system. Hedges, rose bushes, and perennials lined the driveway and edged the currently vacant parking lot. A woman wearing a large straw hat knelt in the wood bark mulch, pulling weeds as Pete eased off the road and up the slight hill. Sandy Gidon climbed to her feet and removed the hat, revealing short-cropped gray hair curling in damp ringlets. She wiped her forehead with a sleeve. Pete stepped out of his SUV and did his best to ignore the twinge in his left thigh, a ghost that still haunted him from the gunshot and shattered femur he'd suffered months ago.
"Doing your own landscaping?" he said.
"Always." She stepped over a plant and onto the pavement.
I can't afford to hire a crew to do it. Besides, I enjoy getting my hands dirty. She swept her gaze across the empty lot. And I don't have anything else to do at the moment.
Good. I need some information, and I was hoping you could help me out.
She plopped the hat back on her head, tugged off her gardening gloves, and pointed toward the motel office. Care for some iced tea?
I'd love some.
A couple minutes later, Pete leaned on the registration desk of the clean but outdated lobby and accepted a tall glass from the motel proprietor.
Is this about the argument? Sandy asked.
He sipped the icy brew and played dumb.
What argument is that?
A man who stayed here last night complained about an argument in the next room when he checked out. I can't believe he filed a police report about it.
Pete set the glass down on a cardboard promotional coaster Sandy had provided.
Victor Hewitt?
That's him. She folded her arms. It's my own darn fault. I only have a handful of guests each night. I should space them out so they aren't right next to each other.
Why don't you?
She shrugged. It's easier for Betsy to clean the rooms when she doesn't have to run from one end of the place to the other.
Made sense. Did Mr. Hewitt mention what the argument was about?
No, just griped that the walls were too thin and he could hear every word the men next door were saying.
Mind telling me who those men were?
Only one man was registered. I guess he had a visitor. She scowled.
Why do you want to know?
Pete hoped she didn't demand a warrant. He took another sip of the tea before answering.
Because, according to Hewitt, one of the men was threatening to kill someone.
The color drained from Sandy's cheeks.
Oh my God! Do you think there's something to it?
Probably not. You know how it is. People get angry and say things they don't mean. But I thought I should investigate, just in case.
She raised a finger. Wait a minute, and ducked behind the counter.
Chief, you know me. I don't rent rooms to anyone I believe might be a problem. I like to think of this place as a family establishment.
She retrieved a sheet of paper from a file.
Although these days I don't get many families. Mostly businessmen who are traveling and need a break from driving.
She set the paper on the counter in front of Pete.
Toby Jones, he read, from St. Louis, Missouri.
Yep.
And he checked out already?
At first light.
Rang the bell and got me out of bed to turn in his key.
Which explained why his vehicle was gone by the time Hewitt left.
Did you happen to see his visitor?
No, I didn't. Sorry.
How about your security cameras?
She huffed. They quit working 6 months ago. I haven't had the money to get them fixed.
Pete tapped the registration form.
Can I get a copy of this?
Sure. She reclaimed the paper, crossed to a machine in the back corner of the office, and returned a few moments later with the copy. Here you go. Her gaze shifted over his shoulder. Hold on a minute. She rounded the desk and headed for the door. Pete turned to see a woman pushing a housekeeping cart past the windows. Sandy opened the door.
Betsy, can you come in here for a moment?
The woman in a dingy white maid's uniform parked her cart against the building and followed Sandy inside.
Is there something wrong?
Sandy folded her arms.
When you cleaned room one, did you find anything odd?
The housekeeper eyed Pete before replying to her boss.
What kind of odd?
Pete fielded the question.
Anything unusual in his trash? Something he left behind? A note, maybe?
He didn't expect a potential killer to leave any breadcrumbs to his planned crime, but it didn't hurt to ask.
No notes.
Betsy wrinkled her nose.
No tip, either, she muttered. As for trash, some empty snack bags from the vending machine, an empty bottle of whiskey, and a couple of our plastic drinking glasses.
That's about it.
Whiskey, Sandy huffed.
I won't be renting to Mr. Toby Jones again, I promise you that.
Do you happen to have his trash bagged separately? Pete asked.
Yeah,
I can get it for you. Betsy started to turn away. I'll walk out with you. He nodded to Sandy. Thanks for your help.
Anytime. I hope it comes to nothing, though.
So do I.
Pete followed the housekeeper to the door, but paused and turned back to Sandy.
Jones was in room one. I gather Hewitt was in room two?
Yep. Mr. Jones checked in early yesterday afternoon, and I put him down at the end. He'd have all the privacy in the world if Mr. Hewitt hadn't shown up.
Pete thanked her again and trailed after Betsy.
Toby Jones of St. Louis was likely well out of Vance Township by now and no longer under Pete's jurisdiction. His visitor was another matter. Pete figured the whiskey had a lot to do with the volume of the voices Hewitt had overheard, as well as the threats. But Pete kept picturing the genuine concern in Hewitt's eyes. It wouldn't hurt to do a little digging. Not when he might be able to stop a homicide before it happened. Zoe suspected the little girl suffered from a shoulder dislocation rather than a broken arm. She immobilized the offending limb and sent the child off to the hospital with her mother. The man in the rumpled shirt had returned the pony to his stall and joined the rest of the gathered crowd as one of the fair's staff drove mother and daughter off in a golf cart. Zoe noticed his hands trembling as he asked,
"Is she gonna be all right?"
"I'm sure she will," Zoe said. "They'll do a closed reduction." She noticed his bewildered expression. "They'll put the shoulder back in its socket. Most likely won't need surgery. She'll be back before evening." Zoe didn't mention she'd be in a brace and wouldn't be handling her pony solo for a while, which was probably for the best anyway. "Is she your daughter?" The question startled him.
"Huh? No."
"Zoe?" The voice from behind them cut him off from elaborating. She turned and came face to face with a woman sporting a flaming red ponytail, flecked with gray, and an older version of a very familiar smile. "Diane?" The woman flung her arms around Zoe. "It's so good to see you." Zoe returned the affectionate embrace. "I wondered if I'd run into you." A lie. Zoe knew she'd run into Diane Garland, her old 4-H leader and pseudo-horse show mom. Diane had been a fixture at every Monongahela County Fair since forever. She took Zoe by the shoulders and drew her an arm's distance away. "It's been way too long. You look great." "So do you." Diane grasped Zoe's left wrist and held it up, an impish twinkle in her eye. "Still not married?" Zoe snatched her hand and naked ring finger away. "Nope. You need a man in your life, Zoe." She shoved both hands into her jeans pockets. Diane Garland loved to play matchmaker, pairing kids with a perfect horse and pairing single women friends with suitable bachelors. "I have a man in my life." Zoe thought of Pete back home in Vance Township and wondered if he'd show up at the fairgrounds after work. A pair of worried creases lined Diane's forehead. "From a look on your face, I'm not sure if that's a good thing or a bad thing." "It's definitely a good thing." The problems they'd had in recent months were all Zoe's fault. She'd lost faith in her own judgment, but in spite of her doubts, Pete never wavered. Still, she needed a week away, and the 10 miles between the fairgrounds and Vance Township fit the bill nicely. Diane smiled broadly. "I'm glad. I've always worried about you being alone." Her true worries about Zoe's past poor choices in men were left unspoken, for which Zoe was grateful. Diane's attention shifted to the man in the plaid shirt who'd started to walk away. "Jack, are you okay?"
Yeah. He didn't sound convincing. Have you seen Vera?
Diane looked around.
No. Have you checked the 4-H barn?
I just came from there. He rubbed his ear. I was looking for her over here when that little girl's pony got away.
Diane studied him, and Zoe recognized the concern in her eyes. Then Diane glanced at Zoe.
Have you met?
Not officially. She extended a hand, which he grasped. Zoe Chambers.
Jack Palmer.
Thanks for your help.
You gals did all the work.
He met Diane's troubled gaze.
That pony there got loose from a little girl. Dragged her halfway down the aisle.
I heard. She touched his arm. Are you sure you're all right? Zoe took a closer look at Jack. He did appear unsteady, almost fragile, enough so that she'd assumed he was the worried father of the injured child. Jack straightened his stooped shoulders.
Well, I'm fine. He pulled out his phone. I'm gonna try to call Vera again. If you see her, tell her I'm looking for her, okay?
Will do. He shuffled away, his phone pressed to his ear. Zoe turned to her old 4-H leader. What was that all about? Diane gazed toward the doorway where he'd exited. Jack's had a rough year. His daughter was in a bad accident this spring. Poor kid's still in a rehab facility or she'd be here. Jack probably looked at that little girl and saw his own kid getting hurt. Well, that's awful. Zoe could well imagine the pain he was going through. Will his daughter be okay? I hope so. Zoe waited for a more definitive answer, but none came. And Vera?
His wife. They've been active in our club since they moved here from Beaver County 2 years ago. After the accident, I thought they'd drop out, but I think they cling to the hope that Cassidy will be back on her horse one day soon. Letting go of the club would be like giving up on that dream.
Zoe mulled over Diane's use of the word dream. She clearly didn't believe Cassidy Palmer would be back, and Diane Garland did not give up on kids easily. The woman shook her head as if clearing away dark thoughts. She turned to face Zoe.
It's great to see you. Are you on standby with the ambulance?
Yes and no. Zoe stooped to pick up the duffel bag containing her first aid gear. I have my horse here, and since I'm going to be around anyway, I'll be spending part of my time on duty.
Diane's eyes brightened the moment Zoe had mentioned her horse. You mean you're entered in the show?
Yeah, my cousin Patsy talked me into it.
Well, good for her.
Diane caught Zoe's hand and squeezed.
Do you remember Cody DeRosa?
The name stirred a quagmire of memories.
Sure, I remember him.
He'd taken the blue ribbon in every class he entered back then. Zoe had never beaten him, never come close. She'd have hated his guts if she hadn't had such a crush on him. He, on the other hand, never gave her the time of day.
He's our judge, Diane said, sounding as excited as a kid with an ice cream cone. All the horse classes all week.
Well, I thought he moved away.
He did. He lives near Columbus, Ohio now. Owns a big quarter horse training facility. Came back just for the fair this year. First time he's been home in over a decade.
Great, Zoe said, feigning enthusiasm. Maybe he was fat and bald now.
3.
Nancy looked up from her desk when Pete returned to the station. She wrinkled her nose.
You're bringing trash in here?
He held up the small bag.
Only a little.
As long as you don't expect me to go through it.
Nancy, have I ever made you dig through trash?
Not the physical kind. Her expression warned he shouldn't start asking either.
Do you have anything I need to deal with?
She held out a trio of pink notes. He left the bag in the conference room and scanned the notes as he headed to his office. A request from a woman asking him to talk to her son about cutting class. A report of wayward cattle tearing up someone's yard, and a report of possible marijuana plants being grown on a local farm. The last one went on top of the pile. Once he settled at his desk and booted up his computer, he placed a call to County Police Detective Wayne Baronic, who headed up the multi-jurisdiction drug task force, and left a message about the not-quite-legal crop. A return call about the cattle revealed they'd already been rounded up and the downed fence had been repaired. Pete set the message from the frustrated mom aside for his next trip out on patrol. He'd hoped a quick call would put the pre-murder matter to rest, or at least point him in the direction of Toby Jones's visitor. Except when Pete phoned the number Jones had written on his motel registration, the person who answered was female and had never heard of him. Pete thanked her for her time and took a closer look at the handwriting. Had he misread one of the numbers? No, he was certain he hadn't. He turned to his computer and typed Jones's car license into the DMV. The number was registered to a 2015 Jeep Compass owned by a Shirley Reed from LaGrange, Missouri. Not the same phone number as Pete had called, and not the red 2001 Honda Civic Jones had written on the paperwork. Pete's jaw ached. Instead of quickly dismissing the overhead threat as nothing more than drunken ramblings, he was finding more and more inconsistencies and raising more and more questions. After another half hour on his computer, he'd located a number of men with the name Toby Jones, none of whom hailed from anywhere in or near St. Louis. No surprise, considering everything else about the man had been fake. Pete leaned back in his chair and thought about the bag of motel room garbage in his conference room. How viable was this threat? Was it worth fingerprinting the whiskey bottle and plastic cups for a homicide that hadn't happened and might never happen? The bells on the front door jingled and a familiar female voice drifted back to him. Nancy didn't bother with the intercom. She didn't need to. A moment later, Sylvia Bassey barreled into Pete's office. "It figures I'd find you in here gathering wool." She plopped her massive purse on his desk and claimed the visitor's chair across from him. "I'm not gathering wool. I'm thinking." "Have you asked her yet?" He blinked. The burgundy velvet box. "Not yet." "What the heck are you waiting for? You aren't getting any younger, you know." Sylvia Bassey, his former police secretary, and, as one of the three township supervisors, his current boss, was one of the few people who knew of his plans. Even Zoe, the intended recipient of the piece of jewelry, hadn't a clue. Which was part of the problem. Pete shifted in his seat. "It's not the right time." "And when, pray tell, will the time ever be right?" He'd rehearsed the moment a thousand times in his head. Dinner at a nice restaurant, wine, candlelight, roses. But between his police duties and her shifts on the ambulance, plus working with the coroner's office, their dates never quite worked out as planned. "Not this weekend or next week. She's camping with Patsy at the fairgrounds." The only way he'd get to see the woman he loved would be to hang out with the horses, cattle, chickens, and goats. Maybe he needed lessons on romance from old MacDonald. E-I-E-I-O. Sylvia came forward and planted her arms on his desk, next to the handbag big enough to hide one of those goats. "Trust me on this, Pete. Tomorrow is never promised. Ask her already." He wasn't sure if Sylvia's fatalistic views were spurred by the loss of her son a year and a half ago, or by her heart attack last winter. "Speaking of, you look great. Are you still planning on doing the Mon 5K this fall?" Her glare faltered, derailed by the flicker of a pleased grin and tinge of pink in her no longer plump cheeks. "Thank you, yes." She cleared her throat and regained her stern matriarchal stance. And stop changing the subject. Pete sighed. The truth is, I'm pretty sure if I proposed right now, she'd turn me down. Bullshit. He tried not to choke. Excuse me? You heard me fine. That girl loves you. She's not going to turn you down. I know she loves me. It's just, she'd been through hell last spring. He may have been the one who got shot, but Zoe was the one carrying the scars. The kind others couldn't see, but Pete knew they were there. Sylvia opened her mouth to continue the argument, but Pete's phone rang. Ordinarily, he'd have let Nancy take the call out front. This time, however, he pounced on it. Vance Township Police, this is Chief Pete Adams.
Hi, Chief, this is Tiffany from Parsons Roadhouse.
The waitress who always sported hair in shades of blue or pink or green. Yes, Tiffany, what can I do for you?
It's probably nothing, she hesitated. But there's a car in our parking lot that's been here all night. It was there when I first got to work this morning, and I thought maybe someone had too much to drink and took a cab or caught a ride with a buddy. But I looked, and it's still there.
Tiffany was right. It was probably nothing, just like the threats made at the Vance Motel last night were probably nothing. I'll come by and check it out, he told her. For one thing, checking out an abandoned vehicle provided a good escape from Sylvia's grilling. For another, Parsons Roadhouse was only about a mile down the road from the Vance Motel. And two probably nothings that close together on the same day might actually be something.
Look who I found wandering around the fairgrounds, Patsy said.
Inside Windstar's stall, Zoe paused, brush in hand, and rested her arms on her horse's back. She looked at her cousin in the aisle, the word who on her lips. But she didn't need to ask. A lanky man with unruly sandy hair and the start of a beard sidled up to Patsy, arms slung around her shoulders.
Oh, Zoe said flatly. Hi, Shane.
Patsy had met Shane Tolland at the beach during one of her increasingly frequent trips to Florida to visit her newly found family. After 6 months of long-distance dating, he'd followed her to Pennsylvania, trailing after her like a large, scruffy puppy. Considering his constant scratching at the stubble on his face, Zoe thought he might even have fleas.
What can I do to help? He asked.
She abandoned grooming her horse and moved to the stall door.
Not a thing. We're all done moving in. Your timing is perfect.
As always. He either didn't catch her sarcasm or didn't care.
Great. He gave Patsy's shoulders a squeeze. Let's go, he said to her. You can show me around.
Patsy looked at Zoe. Do you mind? Zoe waved her off. Have fun. Patsy stood there a moment, eyeing her. Zoe thought, hoped she'd blow Shane off and stick around. After all, the only reason Zoe was at the fair was because Patsy had insisted. But Patsy said, see you later, and walked off arm in arm with her boyfriend. Zoe turned back to Windstar, who stood with one back leg cocked, head low, eyes at half-mast. At least he'd calmed down enough to nap. She patted his neck and slipped out of the stall. Soft, rapid footsteps thumping down the aisle drew her attention to a beaming 9-year-old girl racing toward her.
Aunt Zoe!
Lily! Zoe braced for the collision. The girl, her niece of the heart, but not by blood, flung her arms around Zoe's waist, and Zoe returned the hug. Earl Coulter, Zoe's partner on the county EMS, and his wife Olivia approached at a much more sedate pace. Their daughter bounced up and down in delight.
Can I pet Windstar?
Yes, but you need to remember, no running in the barn and no fast movements. Lily hung her head.
I'm sorry. I was so excited. I know. Zoe gave the girl's ponytail a tug and opened the stall door to let her in.
Sorry about that. Olivia shook her head. This child is completely horse crazy.
Zoe chuckled. Last summer, she'd stayed with the Coulter family for a few months. Lily hadn't been able to understand why Zoe's horse couldn't move in with them, too. She should be in horse heaven around here. Earl exchanged a look with his wife before turning to Zoe.
We have a favor to ask.
Oh? They exchanged another look.
Lily's old enough to join 4-H. We were hoping you might introduce her, us, to some of the leaders.
Zoe glanced into the stall to make sure Lily was heeding the rules Zoe had drilled into her since her first eager visit to the barn. Like no running around horses. The girl stood quietly next to Windstar, letting him sniff her open palm. Zoe smiled. Another young horse lover for Diane to nurture. Sure, let's walk over to the 4-H barn. Prying Lily away from Windstar wasn't too hard once she learned they were going to look at more horses. Olivia kept hold of the girl's hand to corral her enthusiasm. They didn't make it past the goat and sheep pens before Lily dragged her mother off for a closer look.
Did you hear? Earl asked while they waited for his wife and daughter to return. You're not getting rid of me this week after all.
What do you mean?
I traded my schedule. I'd be working standby with you.
Why? Not that I don't love having you as my partner, but being on standby at the fair wasn't usually a prime assignment. For one thing, it meant temporary duty with the crew out of the Brunswick garage instead of their regular gang back in Phillipsburg. For another, Earl lived 5 minutes from their usual post and had a 20-mile drive to get here. And finally, county fair duty tended to be boring. Treating a few scrapes and bruises while spending most of the time doing PR and trying to keep kids from climbing in the ambulance when no one was looking. The only reason I volunteered was because I already have to be here, she said, and I didn't want to use up my vacation days. Earl shrugged.
Looks like I'll be stuck here a lot this week, too.
Zoe looked at him. Why?
Aiden and Ryan.
Earl and Olivia's two teenaged sons. Oh, that's right, I forgot. They're working on the school bus for the demolition derby.
Yeah, but that's only tomorrow morning. They intend to be here all week.
Oh?
They've got the fair bug.
He gestured toward his daughter.
Just not about horses.
Zoe waited for him to fill in the blanks. Girls?
Aw.
And that. Earl gazed beyond the barns and pens toward the midway with its carnival rides and games.
They bought full-week passes with their own money. Aiden said he had a buddy who would drive them back and forth, but Olivia and I aren't about to let those boys in a car with a kid who only got his license last Monday. So I get to chauffeur.
Zoe remembered being the boy's age. Both Earl and his kids were luckier than they realized. He misinterpreted the look she gave him.
I know we could put the hammer down and say no, but both boys got straight A's in the final semester. We'd promised them each a reward, within reason. They've been pondering what they wanted all summer. Since we vetoed matching Corvettes, a week hanging out at the fair turns out to be it.
Zoe watched Olivia and Lily head toward them. As much as she dragged her feet about being here, she remembered how much fun she'd had as a teenager at the fair. And they paid for their own passes? You got off cheap, my friend. 4. Parsons Roadhouse sat at the corner of a T-intersection. Neither of the roads were heavily traveled, and what little traffic passed by was mostly local. Still, the parking lot boasted over a dozen cars, and it wasn't noon yet. Pete had no idea which was the abandoned one. Tiffany, sporting purple hair today, met him the moment he stepped inside.
Thanks for coming, Chief. Like I said, it's probably nothing.
Don't worry about it.
He glanced around at the unmanned bar, too early yet, and the tables, three of which were occupied by early lunch patrons.
How about putting in an order for me, and then you can point out which car has you concerned?
She tugged an order pad and pen from her apron's pocket. Sure thing. What'll you have?
What's the special?
Deep-fried haddock sandwich with fries and coleslaw?
Works for me.
Eat in or take out?
Depends on what I learn when I run the plates on your probably nothing car.
She grinned. Gotcha. A couple minutes later, she returned and led him out to the lot in a black Toyota Camry. That's it. Pete thanked her, and she retreated from the baking sunshine into the air-conditioned restaurant. He strolled to the rear of the vehicle and reached for the two-way clip to his shoulder.
Vance Base, this is Vance 30.
When Nancy responded, he gave her the Pennsylvania plate number. While he waited, he tugged the brim of his Vance Township PD ball cap lower over his eyes and surveyed the lot. One of the other cars had a smattering of stickers in the rear window. Another had a broken taillight. Still, another had a piece of discolored plastic obscuring the license. He bet if he wanted, he could find something to ticket on each and every vehicle there. But he wasn't in the mood. His gaze swept the lot itself. A couple of broken bottles in the gravel provided potential tire hazards. Halfway between him and the road, he spotted a high-heeled shoe and wondered if Cinderella had missed her slipper yet. Closer to the building, a half-dozen or so small brown birds flocked around a spilled takeout box, flying off with what was left of the French fries. His radio static to life.
Vance 30, this is Vance Base.
Vance 30.
The license number you gave me, Nancy said, is registered to a Vera Palmer of 1414 Westview Road, Hancock, Pennsylvania. The 4-H barn was a much newer construction than the old pony barn, but was currently abuzz with the same activities. Parents dragged in tack trunks. Kids decorated the outside of their stalls. Some horses, the ones more seasoned to travel and shows, quietly munched their hay or watched the goings-on. Others, like Windstar, were obviously less accustomed to the hubbub and paced or pawed their stalls. As Zoe and the Coulters strolled down the center of the barn, she noticed Diane Garland stepping from one of the stalls and steered them toward her. "Diane, I want you to meet some friends of mine." Zoe introduced Earl, Olivia, and Lily and noticed the wide-eyed youngster surveying every horse, every kid, every movement going on in the barn. Diane noticed, too, and took over the Coulter family's guided tour. Zoe watched as her 4-H leader picked out one of the horses and ushered the trio toward it. "Zoe?" She turned. The platinum blonde who'd spoken her name wore a thin smile. It took a long moment for Zoe to match this lined, gaunt face with the younger, more rounded version she'd once known. "Marin? Yeah, I'm surprised to see you here." Zoe could say the same. She kept the question she wanted to ask. "Why aren't you still in jail?" inside her head and off her lips. Instead, she lied. "You look great. Love your hair." The glare Marin gave her made it clear she knew better. "Do you have a kid in 4-H, too?" "No." Zoe gestured toward the Coulters and Diane. "Friends of mine are thinking about letting their daughter join." Marin gave an uninterested nod and looked back toward the barn door. "My boy Luke is around here somewhere. Probably down on the midway instead of helping me with his horse." Zoe remembered the boy, a child from one of Marin's earlier marriages, and controlled her surprise that he wasn't locked up in juvie. "I guess I'd better go drag that boy's sorry ass back here before he gets in trouble. I'll talk to you later." Marin stormed away without waiting for a reply. Earl, Olivia, and Lily were talking with a couple of teen girls. Diane broke away from the group and approached Zoe, a smile on her face.
Looks like I have a new 4-H'er.
You know she doesn't have a horse, Zoe said. I'd let her use Windstar, but I think his mouth is too soft for a beginner. He would never hurt the little girl. She, on the other hand, could make his life miserable. Diane dismissed her concerns with a blown-out breath.
Not having a horse has never stopped me from working with kids before.
You know that better than anyone. True. Diane had loaned or leased ponies and horses to many a kid over the years, including Zoe.
I saw you talking to Marin Schultz.
She didn't happen to mention Luke, did she? She said he should have been helping with his horse, but was probably down on the midway instead. Diane rubbed her arms.
Are you busy right now? I have a favor to ask you.
A rumble of murmurs behind Zoe distracted Diane. The 4-H leader's attention, as well as Olivia's and that of all the teenaged girls in the barn, was drawn to something behind her. A man in a silver-belly gray western hat, dark jeans, and spotless cowboy boots swaggered at a leisurely pace toward them. He paused at each stall, gazing in, his movie star smile bracketed by deep pimples. Zoe swallowed the knot that rose in her throat. Crap. The hat concealed whether the man was bald, but Cody DeRosa was definitely not fat.
Sure, I remember Vera, Tiffany said.
Pete sat at one of the tables in the bar, his back to the wall. The haddock, fresh from the fryer, was too hot, so he forked some coleslaw into his mouth.
She's one of a bunch of women who come in every so often.
He held a hand over his mouth as he chewed. How often?
Maybe once every couple of months.
Were they here last night?
Yep. They came for dinner. They started arriving around 6 o'clock or so.
Pete swallowed. Did you see Vera leave?
Tiffany shook her head, her long purple bangs swishing across her face. Neither time.
What do you mean, neither time? The waitress used the back of her wrist to brush the wayward bangs aside.
I wasn't the table server, but I noticed Vera had disappeared at one point. I figured she had to use the bathroom, but she didn't come back. At least, not until the others had left.
Pete jotted the information on his notepad.
What time did the group leave?
Tiffany hummed.
I don't know for sure. Like I said, I wasn't their server.
Who was?
Charlene.
Before he could ask, Tiffany answered his next question.
She has today off.
He made a note.
You said Vera came back later?
Tiffany nodded.
I did wait on her then. She was looking for the others. But like I said, they'd left.
What time was this?
He picked up his fish sandwich and cautiously took a bite.
A little before 10, I think.
Wherever she'd been, she must have been drinking because she was definitely intoxicated.
Had she been drinking here? He asked around the haddock.
Not that much.
Tiffany ran a tongue across her lips.
You'd have to ask, Charlene, but I've served this group in the past, and they're always the same. They have dinner, dessert, and one glass of wine. They're pretty strict about it. Don't want to get pulled over for DUI on their way home.
But Vera appeared intoxicated when she came back?
Yes, very. I was shocked to see her like that. It looked like she'd been crying and her clothes were all disheveled.
He wiped his mouth with a paper napkin.
Then what?
She was upset to find out her friends were already gone and started crying again. I got her a cup of coffee and called Brown's taxi service for her. She said she didn't want it, but I called anyway.
Peter inhaled.
That's it then. She took the taxi home and simply hasn't come back to get her car yet?
Tiffany shook her head, and her purple bangs dropped across her face again.
No, we were busy last night and I didn't see her leave. But the taxi driver came in looking for her. She was gone. I figured she must have driven herself home.
I hated the idea of it, but what else could I do?
You did fine. Is she married?
I think so. She wears a ring, but I don't know her or any of her friends that well, so I couldn't tell you her husband's name.
Pete skimmed back to the page where he'd scrawled Vera Palmer's contact information after Nancy had given it to him.
I'll call her. She probably caught a ride with someone and is home nursing a hangover.
Tiffany smiled weakly.
I hope so. You'll let me know?
Absolutely.
The waitress scurried off toward the pair of men in work uniforms who'd claimed a table close to the door. Pete took another bite of his sandwich and pulled out his phone. Once he'd chewed and swallowed, he punched in the number Nancy had given him. It rang, and a recording answered,
"You've reached the Palmer residence. At the tone, please leave a message."
He didn't. Being requested to call the local cops tended to freak people out, and there was probably no reason for concern. Vera Palmer's husband hadn't reported her missing. Pete dragged a fry through the puddle of ketchup on his plate and studied the address in his notes. Hancock was a small town on the northern edge of the county. Not his jurisdiction, but the abandoned car and the drunken and disheveled woman who owned it bugged the hell out of him. Once again, the phrase, "probably nothing," echoed in his mind. This time, he wanted to quash the "probably" part. He wiped his greasy fingers on the paper napkin, pulled out his phone, and keyed in the station's number. When Nancy answered it, he said,
"Call county and request a wellness check at that address you gave me for Vera Palmer."
With the exception of a few lines on his tanned face, Cody DeRosa hadn't changed much since the last time Zoe had seen him. She'd been in her final year as a 4-H'er, 18 years old and a wild child, right here on these same fairgrounds. He'd beaten her out for a chance to qualify for state, same as he had the last 3 years. Her competitive side had been bruised, but not as badly as her ego when she'd tried every move she knew to catch his eye, and failed. He spotted her, smiled, and approached.
"Hello, Diane."
He extended a hand toward the 4-H leader. Okay, so he'd spotted Diane, not Zoe. Knowing that Pete, at least, had eyes only for her, helped her ego absorb yet another blow.
"It's so good to see you again," Diane said. "I can't tell you how pleased I was to hear you'd be judging the horse show this year."
"Happy to do it. It's been ages since I've been back to my old stomping grounds."
He released Diane's hand and turned to Zoe, bumping his hat up off his forehead with one thumb, revealing a shock of dark hair. Not bald, either.
"Hello there."
His tone and the glint in his eye reminded her of a hungry wolf, but Zoe could tell he had no idea who she was.
"You remember Zoe Chambers, don't you?" Diane said. "You were in 4-H together."
"Well, of course I remember Zoe."
Of course he did not. He reached out and took her hand.
"You look incredible."
Her cheeks warmed in spite of her determination to resist his charms.
"Thanks."
She tried to pull her hand free, but he held tight.
"Do you have a horse in the show?" he asked.
"Yeah."
With her free hand, she gestured in the general direction of the pony barn. "I'll be in the open glasses."
"Excellent. We'll have to get together later and reminisce about old times."
She tried again to retrieve her hand and again failed. Inside her head, she pointed out to him that they had no old times about which to reminisce.
"That'd be great."
No, it wouldn't. Maybe she could bring Pete along.
"Excellent. I'll track you down later."
Cody released her hand and swaggered away, pausing to speak with Olivia. Zoe noticed Earl sizing up the cowboy.
"He's still an insatiable flirt," Diane said. "He can't seem to help himself." Didn't I hear he got married? Twice, but neither marriage lasted long. Both women thought they could tame him. Diane shook her head. Didn't happen. Cody apparently realized Olivia was off limits. He nodded to Earl and made his way toward the far door as Patsy and Shane strolled in. Zoe watched the introduction and flirtation routine begin anew. Olivia and Lily continued to chat with the girls, but Earl, phone in hand, moved towards Zoe and Diane.
The boys are ignoring my texts and calls. I bet they're scouting out the games on the midway, so I'm gonna take a walk and track them down.
From the tone of his voice, he had some stern words for his sons once he found them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.